going.
I see the red lights on.
Okay, well, that means we're going. This is Jack Hansen. The date is 1/22/93. And Jack Hansen was the caretaker for Sylvan Beach for many years. Jack, do you want to tell us when you first came to Sylvan Beach, what year that was?
It was March 1955. Yeah, I'm sure of that, yeah.
Was March, okay.
Mm-hmm.
Did you have anybody to help you then? Did you have an assistant?
Not for a while. This kind of comes as a sudden thing, and during March, of course, there wasn't much to do anyway, so it did give me a little time to look over the situation and see what I needed and who I needed.
Okay.
So it wasn't a short time later that I run into Louis Baxter.
Okay.
And he was a real good fellow around the resort with me.
Now, how many years was he your assistant?
Well, let's see. I'm trying to think of what year he passed away. I think it was 20 years.
20 years he was
yeah.
with you. Wow. I certainly do remember that. Can you tell us what your duties were that first year, what the caretaker did in 1955?
Well, of course, the first thing to do in the spring is to get the place cleaned up. Yes, people know there were quite a few leaves laying around, and then as soon as you could possibly do it, which was the 1st of May, you had to turn on the water system for all the cottages, and then you had to get each cottage all hooked up with their water and get them ready for the occupants. It was time-consuming and a lot of hard work.
Right.
Because you had just a certain amount of time to get everything cleaned up and get the cottages ready, because some of them come early. Most of them didn't come till after school was out. But you had to have everything set for Memorial Weekend, that was for sure.
You had to have it all done then.
Because probably, I'm guessing there a little bit, but you probably, Memorial Weekend, you had at least 90% of the people on the resort, maybe just for the weekend.
Mm-hmm.
Then they go back home, and then when school was out, they would start trickling back into their cottages for the summer.
How many cottages had their own wells at that time?
Oh, golly. There was not very many, just a few.
Mm-hmm.
I'd have to go back and do a little thinking. I could probably come up with that figure, but there wasn't very many of them.
Okay, the water then at that time, most of it came off the system that Sylvan Beach had. Where did they get the water from?
From the wells.
Oh, it was from wells that
yeah.
Sylvan Beach owned.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, they said those were down there in what we call the flatlands, just as you come in. And the same... they still got the wells in the same place, even yet today, I think. As far as I know, at least they run them for fire protection or something like that. But in those days, they did everything. They had the fire lines and the individual houses. And it all had to be taken care of.
weren't you sheriff also of Fruitland Township, or?
No, I was a special deputy for the county. For the county, just because of my position there at the resort, gives you a little authority. I didn't go out chasing around or anything.
Yeah, weren't chasing crooks down.
No. The thing of it was that, I mean, if somebody got into a little trouble and. You just have to kind of show them this little badge, you know, and that usually was the end of everything. No problems.
Okay. Was there many problems during the off season down there in the winter time? Did you have many problems, or
very few? There were very few break-ins. I think I remember once. I can't tell you the year that was either. But there was about 1, 2, 3. I think it was 4 places broken into during Christmas time.
Wow.
And outside of that, probably one or two more over the period of years, but very little malicious stuff down there.
Well, probably because you were also down there too at the time, yeah, guarding it, and there was somebody that lived there.
Yeah, they knew there was somebody there, and they say, take your walks every day and see if everything was all right. And, well, give me a little exercise in the winter.
And it's still good down there to do that, to walk. Can you tell me the names of your first wife and children that were raised down there?
Oh, of course, my first wife was Evelyn.
Right.
And see, Ann was the only one born there. The others were born on Scenic Drive, where I lived before. Okay. And but they all grew up there and went to school from there and had a good time. I mean, it was really good for the kids, I thought. I think probably maybe that was one of the reasons that I accepted the job. When I was asked, I'd been asked twice to take it.
Who asked you?
Oh, golly. I think Bill Vandevander was the first one. And I think that was in 1948, because I had just built my house on Scenic Drive. And so I said, no, this time I don't think I'd better take it. So then, I guess it was a few years later, well, probably around 54, I was asked again if I would like the job. So I talked to Ruth Evelyn, and I said, I think it would be a good place for the kids. They could go swimming. They all love to swim.
Sure.
And I like to ice fish. Couldn't find a closer place to go.
Yeah, you're right on the way.
And it was just all around good.
It was a good place to raise the family.
That's right. And we all seemed to get along pretty good, even with the kids. And I never had much trouble with the kids.
No, just a few guys like me around.
There was a little devilish business going on, but hell, if I wanted an extra hand, I could call on any one of you. And you was jumping over there.
Yeah, that's true too. I remember we used to put the swimming diving board in every June with you and
sometimes
Louie.
Sometimes you'd just come over. All I had to do was holler. Somebody was always there to help.
Yeah. I remember John Mill and I did that a couple of times with you. To kind of stray from Sylvan Beach in a way, I can remember you telling me a story that I thought was really fascinating, and I'd kind of like if you'd repeat it again, if you could recall it, the time there was an incredible snowstorm in the 20s or 30s here.
Oh.
And you guys had to shovel from Whitehall halfway to Muskegon.
That was quite a winter, the winter of 36. I was in high school, of course, in Montague, and we couldn't get home. So fortunately, Walter Hunt, he lived in Montague, and his wife was teaching school at Rothbury, and she couldn't get home. So Walter says, well, he had his brother George and Johnny O'Connell and myself that was going there. And he says, well, just stay out of my place. We'll batch it some way or another. So that's what we did. And that was a real winter, I can tell you that. Well, I got home twice in 3 weeks on a pair of skis from Montague down to Scenic Drive.
You're kidding.
Yeah. And I'd take some mail down to some of the neighbors. But, of course, we didn't have any school. We couldn't operate the schools. Walter had the garage there in Montague, so George and I would go down in the morning and start the old stoves that they had, the old heating stoves, you know. So I remember that one morning, I think it was 30 below zero.
How much snow was on the ground at this time?
Oh,
how much
golly.
Of a storm dump?
You couldn't hardly, it was kind of hard to tell. I mean, I couldn't remember that anymore. But it was so windy, it was the drifts is what caused the problems.
Okay, so 1936 was probably the worst one that you can remember, you
think? Oh, yeah. That's when I can... I've never seen anything any worse, because it just kept piled up. Of course, you didn't have the equipment, the snow removal equipment. And one morning, they said, well, we got to open the road to Muskegon. So I said, everybody's got a shovel, let's get going. And I think there was 55 of us left Whitehall with shovels. And we had the county plow with us. He had a little 12-inch blade on the front of the truck. And Muskegon, they sent out a bunch. And so, and we met out at Dalton. The Whitehall bunch got to Dalton and the Muskegon bunch got there. And if I remember again correctly, they said that some of the drifts at Dalton there were 23 feet deep.
My goodness.
And so then on top of that, the train got stuck there just north of Montague in that little ravine. So we went up and shoveled the train out.
My God.
So, you know, it was an interesting winter, I'll tell you that.
So people started from Muskegon to shovel, and they started from Whitehall headed toward Muskegon, and with a 12-inch blade on your side, that shows you how much of equipment we didn't have.
Yeah, I mean, there just wasn't any equipment to remove the snow. And of course, during the winter, it used to be put up the ice for the ice houses out of the lake, White Lake and Duck Lake. And they didn't want the plows to come by and clear the roads, because then the horses and the sleighs couldn't haul the ice. They scraped them down, you know, and the sleighs weren't very good.
Didn't work, yeah.
No, so. But then later on, of course, when they got trucks to haul the ice and stuff, why, everything changed.
Okay.
Going from one century to the other in a hurry.
That's good. Can you tell us the down at Sylvan Beach? First of all, where were these ice houses located where you put the ice?
Oh, golly. Well, Sylvan Beach had one. That was the old ice house at Sylvan Beach, is Kelly Sellers' boathouse.
Oh, wow. Now. Okay.
And then there was Michelinda Beach. They had a big ice house. And there was quite a few independents, like the Butterfields. They had their own ice house. And let's see, Potter's Resort, they had their own. And the Boy Scouts, they had their own. It seemed like there was a couple more. Rudy Schiller had one. Well, that was quite a job in the wintertime putting up ice.
Kept you busy for the summer, yeah.
You kept you busy in the summer. It kept you busy putting it up.
I bet it did.
That's about the hardest work that I think I ever did, is put up ice.
Okay, now, did you cut it out of the lake? Did you saw it out of the lake?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. They had John Peterson, the old gent, lived up on Lakewood Road. And he had a gasoline engine with a big saw on it, big round saw. And he could cut it down, maybe 8-10 inches, maybe 6 to 8 inches probably, the saw would go down in the ice. And he'd get it all squared out and cut in squares. And then when you got ready to load it, and they'd slide it up the channel, they'd cut a channel right up to the slide, wooden slide to go right up into trucks or whatever it was. And then all you had to do was, there was just single blocks, and when they come up there, they hit them with a spud, and it would break them in smaller pieces, approximately 100 pounds of cake.
So they started out at 100 pounds, and yeah. Then you'd split it with a spud from that point on?
Or no, when you finish splitting that, they'd come in a whole chain.
Okay.
And you just hit those where they were sawed. See, they didn't go all the way through.
Okay.
Just hit them like that, and they'd break apart. And no, the finished product was approximately 100 pounds. Depending on how thick the ice was, of course.
Well, yeah. How long in the summer did that last?
Well, you see, And that was before my time at the resort, but I think they had enough for all summer.
Wow. So they basically fill Sellers building with ice.
With ice, and then you take, of course, and it was all covered with sawdust, and sawdust was all around insulation, and the whole building was insulated with sawdust, and then you put sawdust between the layers. So when you took the top layer off, the next one didn't melt.
Didn't stick, okay.
Didn't melt. See, that was the thing. You had to keep them from melting or you wouldn't have any ice all summer.
So the sawdust acted as your insulation. I'll be darned. I never heard that.
Yeah.
That's wild. Now, if you could remember, when the people at the resort, the ice was just given to them during the summer. That was just part of the caretaker's duties. To cut the ice and then the people could come and get the ice, or do they have to buy it?
No, I don't know how they charge them for it, but as a rule, the caretaker delivered it.
Oh, wow, to every house, huh?
Yeah.
That's daily then, probably.
Gee whiz, I can't tell you the last caretaker that carried ice. It could have been Hib Thomas, but I'm not sure.
Okay.
Oh, I'm not sure. Because it wasn't, there again, not being on the resort, I can't tell you when they switched. But then Waller Brothers started the ice business in Whitehall. And so they would deliver the ice. And that was about the end of putting up private ice houses.
Could you give me a year approximately for that? Okay, no problem.
I'd say probably in the late 30s, but I sure wouldn't be sure of that date. It'd have to be around there someplace, because I could say, I don't even remember when Waller Brothers, I remember distinctly when they started the ice business, but I couldn't tell you the year. But it'd have to be right around in there someplace.
Okay, late 30s probably then.
Yeah,
somewhere in there.
But there again, that's a guess.
Okay, you assumed the caretaker duties in 1955. Can you tell us what equipment you had, trucks or whatever you used at that time?
Well, we had the old GMC truck. And the only lawnmower we had was an old sickle bar. It was good for cutting weeds, but it wasn't worth a darn for cutting anything else.
What's a sickle barn? Can you describe that to us?
It's a machine. It's just a bar in front, probably, I think this was 36 inches. And it worked just like a mowing machine for cutting hay and stuff. The scissors go back and forth.
Boy,
and then you could push it in there. And you use it a couple of times, then you had to have some parts.
So you were you responsible at that time for mowing all the lawns?
Oh, no. No.
Who did that?
Well, back in those days, I think before I come there wasn't hardly any mowing done. Some people had them, but kids in the neighborhood. In those days, kids, regardless, they would always work. The O'Connell boys, Johnny's kids, they cut. People that had nice lawns, they did have them cut, you see.
Mm-hmm.
But they were about the only kids that I think cut grass over there.
I'll be darned. So a lot of people didn't mow their lawns.
They
just came up for the summer and to heck with it and have some fun.
It was just a matter of I'd say just a year or so, though, before we got our hand mowers, and Louie and I started cutting all the lawns, too, that wanted it.
Wow. And did you charge extra for that?
Well, it was charged through the association.
Association, okay.
Yeah. I'd keep track of all. You had to keep track of everything you did for the individuals. You hooked up their cottage for the water, took down the shutters and put up the screens, and it's whatever hours you worked, they just kept track of it, and then at the end of the year, I'd send those bills all in. And so cutting grass the same way. They had a set price for it, so much an hour. And so I'd just keep track of it every day.
Okay.
And send it in.
send it all in and let the Secretary Treasurer handle the breakdown of the situation.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Wow.
You split it up. I mean, like, if I bought a new mower, that was separate. I mean, I kept stuff separate for the treasurer.
Okay.
If something we did, like hook up your house, that was under one column, and if I bought a new mower, that was under another one. And
did you keep a ledger then, I would imagine, on this activity, or just notebooks, or?
Well, mostly just notebooks.
Notebooks. Did you save any of those by any chance?
Gosh, I don't know if I got any or not.
Well, if you ever find
probably
a
not.
Me, I would like to.
Probably not, because I had a loose leaf folder that I had, it was probably a good inch and a half thick of all the stuff on the resort. Every cottage. It was down there where the drains were and all that stuff, you know, and every dock was numbered and it was in the book, and I turned all that over to Ron.
Okay.
And so I didn't keep stuff.
How many years were you caretaker there? What was your last year as caretaker at Sylvan Beach?
Well, I was there 26 years. Well, almost. If I stayed till March, it had been 26 years. But I didn't want to stay that late because I wanted whoever was going to be the new caretaker to have time to go in and get settled and stuff before you had to go to work.
That's right, figure things out. And
yeah, you got to, you don't learn those things overnight.
No, and each cottage, I would imagine, was its own nightmare for you.
Oh, some of them are a corker.
Yeah,
some
yeah.
Of that old, the old original plumbing in some of those places, you know, you didn't dare tighten it too tight.
Yeah. Might not have any plumbing, you know?
Yeah, you might not have any pipes left.
Oh, shoot. If you need to take a break or anything, just let me know.
Oh, go ahead. Okay? Go ahead for a little while.
Okay. Can you tell me, do you happen to remember who was your first president when you went to Sylvan Beach? Who was the president of Sylvan Beach?
I think it was George Howell.
Mr. Howell, okay. And your last president was who? Brooks Davis? Or?
Yeah, Brooks was the last one, yeah.
Yeah, I think
that's right. Yeah, Brooks Davis was the last one. Now there was quite a few in between.
A lot of them, many bosses. Huh? Can you tell us in the fall you turn off the water and you close the cottages? Can you tell us what date that was done generally?
Well, of course that all varied except for two things. You turned the water on the 1st of May. The main system went on the 1st of May, and it was drained the 1st of November. And after the 1st of November, you just couldn't trust the weather anymore, so you wanted to make sure, because if that ever froze up, you would have one big mess.
Yeah, so you had them all turned off by November 1st,
yep.
Then, okay, that was the cutoff day. And May 1st, they were all to be on by May 1st. And then,
yeah.
Can you tell us some of the duties that you were doing then that might be different from now, some of the extra duties that the caretaker now doesn't have to do or he gets paid a lot extra for? Or?
Well, I guess probably the biggest thing is cleaning up the resort. Now I guess they hire that done by, I think Mr. Seaver does.
Seavers, yeah.
We used to always do that by hand. Take the rake and your forks and get busy, boys. But I was fortunate in the spring. There again, I go back, the kids would work. You could get some kids to really work. So I called Mr. Townsend at the Montague School and, Eldie, I need a couple of good kids for 2 or 3 weeks. When do you want them? So I'd have a couple of boys come down and about four of us, Louie and I and the two kids, we could usually get her done and have it, I think only 1 year that we didn't have it finished by Memorial Weekend. Because that one spring, and there again, I couldn't tell you the year, rain every day. Just put us back and back and back farther. And then, of course, somebody calls for a cottage, you have to lay the rake down and go get the cottage ready. And so you had to work with the weather. No getting around that.
Yeah.
If in nice days, you was out raking. If you got a lousy day, even if the people weren't coming, you'd go get the place all ready so you could turn the water on any time.
Yeah, you had to get that done anyhow. So.
Yeah, but say, in a job like that, you just have to work with the weather.
Yeah.
And it's the same way with your docks. Put the docks in, if you get an east wind with a good strong east wind, you don't want to be out there in that lake. And it's cold.
Oh, yes, yes, cold as can be.
So, that's the most important thing, I think, is working with the weather down there.
Weather down there.
And you
so only one year the weather kind of beat you just one time. That's pretty good.
Yep, I think we were very fortunate.
Admirable, yeah.
It was fun if we could get started about the middle of April. Then you didn't have any problems at all.
Then you didn't have to push too much.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
So. Did they give you a budget to hire kids with? Did you have like $1,500 or something? Or
$800? No. If I wanted a couple of kids, I'd just tell whoever was chairman of the grounds, I'm going to get a couple of kids, and we set a price per hour. That's all there was to it. If the kids worked 2 weeks, fine. If it took us 3 weeks, fine.
Whatever it took.
I mean, it's the only way you can do those things.
Nothing wrong with that.
No. I say everything was very peaceful and everybody was very cooperative and everything went smooth.
The times seem to have changed somewhat.
Boy, I guess so.
We won't go into any of that. do you recall the worst storm in the summer you ever had? Was there any storm or particular time where the because you're up in the middle of the night when it storms helping people with boats and that, or not even helping them, you're doing it yourself?
Oh gosh, I could probably get that for you. It'd take me a little time because I always kept track of the weather.
Oh, that's right. You had the calendar back in the garage, and you always write down. I remember that.
Yeah, I still got them.
Oh, do you really?
Yeah, I still got them. And the only thing I can tell you down there, I remember my three times my wind gauge got up to 70 miles an hour.
Where'd you have the wind gauge?
Right on top of the house.
On top of your house, okay.
Yeah, I still got that, too.
You still have that one, too?
I got it right here. And probably one of the worst ones we had was, as far as storms concerned, was the night that the bomb club burned.
Oh, okay.
Boy, I'm telling you, she was hitting 70 that night. Because in my house, right there, right out of the east, my caretaker's house down there was a little shaky.
Yeah. So when the WAP club burned, when did you first find out about it? Being a howling east wind, it must have been...
You couldn't hear anything. You couldn't tell. And first thing I knew, somebody was pounding on the door and said the WAP club's on fire.
I believe that was Mike Esch, wasn't it? A fisherman?
No, it wasn't. He that pounded on the door. Okay. I heard the name. I think he saw the fire when he was driving down South Shore Drive.
Okay.
But it was Johnny O'Connell that the fire engines went by Johnny's house, so that's what woke him up. And he come over, of course, and I think it was John that finally pounded on the door and got me up.
Can you describe that night with the WAP club on fire and the howling east wind and what
thunder
you did?
Thunder and lightning and holy smokers. There was nothing you could do. I mean, the firemen, they were trying their best, but with that wind, it was a losing proposition all the way around.
Did they get their water from the lake? Could they chip through the ice, or did they have to use the water carriers on the trucks?
Well, they used the water carriers. And but it was definitely lightning that did it. We were all positive of that.
Lightning. Okay.
We was a little bit skeptical of it at first, whether it was lightning, but then shortly afterwards, I can't even think of the day that thing burned.
I think it was in February, March 79.
Could have been. I still got the papers.
You still have the papers, okay. I came up after a couple weeks after it burned down. I think it was like February 79. I could be wrong, but it was right in there.
Because I know when we hooked up Mr. Dennison's place up on the hill, didn't seem to have any power. I looked all over it. I couldn't find anything wrong with the fuse boxes or anything like that. So I called Howard Durham, the electrician, and had him come down and check it because Mr. Dennison was coming. And there again, I never had an argument about if something was wrong, I'd go ahead and get it fixed. They never give me, it was perfectly okay with them because it had to be done. So, and he come down and the big cable underneath the house was hit by lightning. So I'm sure today that's what caused the Wub Club fire, was the lightning.
What did you do that night when it was on fire, when Mr. O'Connell was banging at the door? What did you immediately do, and how long did it take before everybody left the scene?
Oh, gosh. Huh. Well, of course, the first thing I did was put my clothes on.
Yeah.
And then I went down there to see what anything you could do, but and there was nothing you could do. I mean, actually, it was lucky that they had enough firemen there to take care of the thing that could have really happened was when it started going up Sellers Hill.
Yeah.
That was the big problem, because they knew they couldn't do anything for the club. Because you take a wind like that, man.
And that club was so old and dry and wiring and, oh, man.
No, I don't think the wiring. I think the wiring, they had that pretty well fixed
okay.
up. Yeah, no. I'm definitely think it was lightning.
And the Leitner cottage caught fire next door too, partially, as
yeah.
I remember.
Yeah, from flames. And of course, what I see with the east wind there, well, everything
yeah.
was going, and boy. And of course, that old pine, it gets hotter than Toby.
Yeah.
And as you say, that was so dry and brittle and. No, I was always scared every time they had a jinx over there.
Well, I was just thinking of that, and I was about to ask you that next day. I remember when I was growing up, and for many years, you would be out there in the road guiding the cars by on jinx night, because that Wop Club was right on the road.
That's
there,
right.
Almost.
Those kids are scary to death, because they come tearing out of that building, you know, they never looked or nothing, and so, fortunately, we never had an accident or anything there.
Thank God, yeah.
Yeah, because that could have been serious.
Oh, yeah, and there were so many times it could have happened there. That's true. I can remember many times, not many times, but several times when there'd be pouring down rain and on jinx night, and you'd still be out there with your flashlight and your yellow raincoat on and your hat, and thank God that you were there.
Yeah. Well, I was always, because I always liked kids, and if I could do anything to help I tried to.
Well, you certainly helped us all a lot back then. We were devilish at times, but you were always good and sincere, and that was nice.
Well, I mean, kids, they're not mean. They think they're having fun, and so you go along with them.
Yeah.
If you get a little too strict with them, they think, oh, that doggone old guy, we'll get straightened out with him.
Yeah. Yeah, somebody's going to raise heck. Now, we never got to list your children. There was
Judy.
Mary, Beth, and Ann, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and those were the kids you had there. And, of course, I can always remember, for years, you had your dog, Heine, back there.
Oh, yeah.
Was always down there.
Yeah, that's, the dog.
Tied up along the side there. And
yeah, it was, in the wintertime, we'd let him run, but in the summertime, we had to tie him up.
Yeah.
Because, which is all right, I mean, because a bunch of dogs running around down there wasn't any good.
Yeah, there was always somebody that didn't want that.
Yep. So, and I don't blame them. If you don't want dogs running around, fine and dandy, don't let them run. So it's,
Wasn't it your daughter, Ann, that used to play down there with Ann Dacey, too? They play down in that driveway with the dog. And
oh, yeah, gosh, yes. Ann Dacey, she got bit.
By Heine?
Uh-huh.
Uh-oh.
Well, she come by with the club one day and whaled him, and the next time she come by, he wasn't such appreciative of it.
Well, justly deserved, I'd say.
Yeah.
Justly deserved.
Yeah, and of course, you always had a cat, you know, kind of took care of the mice and stuff. When I first come over there, you wouldn't believe the rats were around there.
You're kidding.
Oh, yeah, that old garage they had, you know. Old wooden floors in it. And
is that where the present one is
yep.
now?
Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And, boy, the rats just loved underneath that floor. And then in the old ice house, they didn't use that anymore, so there was rats over there, too. And I had this big old tomcat we had before I brought him along. And he had no use for rats. He was a good one, too. So between me and the shotgun and my dear old cat, we got rid of the rats eventually. And
I can remember that old shotgun of yours. I remember I borrowed that one day and shot the whole day with it, and it had a wooden stock, and the next day I felt like I'd broken my shoulder.
Well, I still got that too, so.
Do you really?
Oh, yeah.
Great. You know what I like to see is maybe those calendars sometime we'll get out and look at the, want to videotape those and look at the dates. That's great that you saved them.
Yeah, I think I got them all.
How soon after you were there did the garage get built and you got a new truck or things like that? It seems to me probably about the time you came, things were beginning to change quickly in this world and probably down there.
Well, let's see. The only thing I can tell you, we got the new truck in 71. Yeah, let's see. What was that other thing you just said? Truck in the...
Oh, in the... garage building there.
Oh.
Was there, how soon was it?
Golly, it wasn't too long, but there again you'd have to check with somebody else on the exact year that we built the garage, because I had the cement work done and then Louie and I did the woodworking, the roof and doors and windows and all those things. Louie and I did those.
You built all that yourself and
yeah.
did it yourself.
Yeah. And but I couldn't tell you the year. You'd have to, it would have to be 55. I'd say 58, 59. It was probably 3-4 years that we put up with the old one. And the old one was getting so bad. You couldn't keep it clean.
Yeah.
It has old floors in there and stuff. You just couldn't do anything with it, so.
Yeah.
And so we decided to put up a new garage. And so the board asked me, what would you like? So I drew up some plans and showed them to him. Said, we can't see anything wrong with that. Go ahead and do it.
Do you remember who was president then, the grounds chairman at that time? During the off-season, what did you occupy your time with concerning Sylvan Beach affairs? What did you do?
Well, the only thing that you did was to check the resort.
Okay.
And I usually checked half of it one day and the other half the next day. Every other day, in other words.
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, I had permission, Louie and I, if somebody wanted some interior work done in some of their cottages, we could go ahead and do it for them.
Okay.
And we would keep that pay.
Okay, that would be separately, which should be done. You were simply contracting
yeah.
that out. And,
yeah.
So you did work on the inside, build screens and things like
oh,
that?
Oh, no. Mostly kitchens. I love to build kitchens.
I'll be doing it.
So, I don't know, I must put 3 or 4 kitchens in on the resort. Oh, little other little jobs, you know, just small stuff. Painting. Paint some rooms for them. And you could do that in the places that had heat.
Yeah.
And and there was a few of them. As I say, we painted them in the wintertime. Give us something to do, and we was always on the resort that way.
Right.
We went out someplace 100 miles away from there.
Your assistant, Mr. Baxter, basically worked the whole year then with you on and off with different people that wanted things done.
Let's put it this way. When I took the job and said that I found Louis, I says, I want you to pay him the year round. If I need some help, something goes wrong here, I can call him.
Yeah.
And he's obligated to come. And you never know when something's going to happen. Get a big windstorm, shutters blow off or something like that, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, it's certainly a good idea, and it was certainly the only fair thing to do to Mr. Baxter would be to guarantee him a job.
That's right.
Something we could learn from.
Our pay wasn't that high to begin with,
yeah. Yeah, speaking of that, I happened to handle your pension fund there at the end. As I remember, all you got was probably about $3,500 for an asparagus field, or what did you finally get when you left the resort for a pension or for a lump sum settlement? Or
no, they put it in IRA.
Oh, okay, so you did you take that with you and then cash it, or?
It was all set up, I just left it right in the bank.
Okay.
It was all set up that way, so I just left it alone.
Well, that was nice. I remember when we hired. Did Mr. Baxter receive any pension?
Yeah. He got put it in the IRA, same as mine. And
do you have any ballpark figures for those two, or?
Oh boy. Go back, I could probably come up to this, but there must have been about 15,000
total.
Yeah, no. Mine and Louis, of course, he wasn't there as long as I was. I don't remember what his was. I'm just guessing again, but maybe 7. I couldn't tell you.
Okay. Just a question, and you don't have to answer this, of course, if it's not pleasant, but what was the hardest day you had at Sylvan Beach? Was there any time in particular with storms or problems or anything that was a particular bad time for you at that point?
Well, pretty much all general.
Generally that way, isn't it?
You get a damn good east wind, and you was down there tying up boats or finding them or something like that, and that happened quite a few times. Fill up with water and sink, and but just things like that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, those and late night storms were never fun for you. You were always out there.
No, and but still, they just kept you on the ball. That's all.
I bet you were happy when summer was over and you could kind of get back to a normal.
Well, like you always said, yeah, I like to see him go and you like to see him come back.
Just in between time.
Yeah.
That's great. Let's stop for a second.
Yeah.
Take a little break here. And take that off.
I'm going to let you take it off. She's on.
Okay, we're on. Okay, thank you, Jack, for that plum wine elixir. can you tell me, just so we'll have it on tape, where the old Sylvan Beach Hotel was?
Well, let's see, who owns that now? Huh. Well, it was right next to the Holloway Cottage, was the annex, and the next one south was who built on that? Oh, gosh.
Jackman?
Nope. Well, Jackman was part of the property, because the wall, I think, is still there between Jackman's and, well, what's the next one down there?
Fields?
Fields bought that lot in there and built on it.
Okay. And that's where the hotel was?
Mm-hmm.
Right in there. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what year did that burn down?
No, they tore it down.
Okay.
No, they tore that down. I don't even remember who did it.
What cottages are not a part of Sylvan Beach?
Well, that sidewalk that runs there alongside of the old Bogart house was the dividing line. So in other words, Stewart's and Hartman cottages, they're not on the resort.
Okay.
They're in the Flitcraft subdivision. And then across the street the same way. Howells, at the time, Howells was the last one.
Okay.
And across the street there, across that sidewalk, was, again, in Flitcraft's edition.
Do you remember Flitcraft at all?
Oh, yes.
Oh, you do?
Well, yeah.
Can you tell us something about him? Was he a troublemaker? I mean, you read all kinds of things.
No, see, they weren't on the resort, Flitcraft.
Okay.
But there at one time we took care of those cottages. When I first went there, it was a separate account, of course.
Okay.
But we still took care of them. And the same way with the old Bogart place. See. But they eventually turned their property over to the association. So they're legally on the association.
Bogart,
the old Bogart. I don't know who bought it now.
Yeah, I'm not sure myself either.
But the other ones down there, the Hartman cottages and the Stewart place, they're still not on the resort. So.
Okay, do you have any memories of Mr. Flitcraft?
Oh, yeah. Chet Flitcraft, he was quite a small gentleman. Nice fella. And what was he? Had a brother, Flitcraft. I used to caddy for those people when I was a kid.
I'll be darned.
And
who else did you caddy for?
Oh, golly. Pretty near all of them out over there, the old timers.
Who ran the golf club at that time?
Ernie Augustine,
okay.
Yeah, of course, I caddied for quite a few years. And so I got to know a lot of people. And they say the majority of the players in those days were from Sylvan Beach and Michelinda Beach.
Mm-hmm.
And
what was Mr. Flitcraft like? I remember in the Sylvan Beach history there was some kind of feud between Sylvan Beach and Mr. Flitcraft. Was Mr. Flitcraft a rough man to get along with, or was he a good man? Or
as far as I was concerned, I had very little to do with him, but
mm-hmm.
I always got along with him.
Mm-hmm.
So, but if he had problems with some of the others, that was none of my business.
That's great. What year did Mr. Flitcraft die? Do you remember?
Oh, no. Gosh, no, I wouldn't. I wouldn't have the slightest idea. But it's quite a few years ago.
What could you tell us what changes occurred in the White Lake area and Sylvan Beach, although you weren't there? Can you remember anything in specific around the golf club or this time when the Second World War broke out? Was there rationing? Was there problems with trying to get food or gas? Or was there a change in things?
Oh, we had ration cards, yes, for gas and stuff. I was very fortunate. I was working in Muskegon, so I had a pretty good-sized gas rationing card. And worked in a defense shop.
What defense shop were you working
in? I was working in Morton Manufacturing.
What did they make for the war effort?
Big, large machine tools. All big equipment.
Uh-huh.
Like, oh, big traveling heads, and I mean, these machines weighed tons, and they were for the government, and of course, spent a couple of years in Uncle Sam's Navy.
Can you tell us something about that?
Oh.
What'd you do in the Navy?
I was assigned to an LST as a water tender, and I spent about a year in the Pacific. And
whereabouts in the Pacific?
We went all the way to Japan.
Wow.
And fact is, we were, why they ever put an LST in a convoy, I don't know. It took some of the army in for the surrender of Sasebo. And of course, shortly after that, we got caught in that big typhoon in 45. Got smashed up pretty bad, but we made her back. And
Was that the typhoon where we lost, as I remember, several destroyers, several ships, actually a couple flipped over?
There was an awful lot of damage. Of course, we didn't see too much. We saw some of the damage.
Can you tell us what an LST was?
Large, slow target. Fourteen knots was top speed. They were just a big, they were built to transport tanks.
Okay.
Now they had big, great big open bows and bow doors.
Yeah, huge.
Yeah. And, we carried some small boats. We loaded those up. We got a new ship in Hingham, Massachusetts, and then we went to New York and put on some small craft inside and on the decks, loaded up, and we carried a tremendous amount of fuel so we could supply other ships.
Mm-hmm.
And we headed out, went down to, started through the canal, and somehow or another, one of our water tanks blew up. So we stayed there in Coca-Cola for a week and saw Panama pretty good and tried some of their rum and coke. And so we got underway, and when we was down at the other end of the canal, the Liberty ship plowed into us. So we stayed for another couple of weeks till we got fixed up. So we saw some more. And we left there, and 31 days later, we was in Hawaii. That was a long trip.
I imagine 14 knots. That's not an LST going across the Pacific. I didn't even know they took those things across the Pacific.
Oh, yeah. Heck, they were all over the world.
Yeah. But that's not a real stable, it's, as you say, the bow opens up and the stuff comes out and...
But they were pretty sturdy. We went right through that typhoon.
All
we lost was the bow doors.
You said that you were a water tender. What duties did you perform?
Well, on our ship, our engineering officer said, you got a water tender's insignia, but he says, you're a little bit of everything. You made the water. That was your main job. From salt water, you made regular water.
Huh.
And then you took care of the fuel oil, make sure all that stuff had to be purified, and your fuel oils that all had to be, right, strain it, make it as clean as possible. And stuff like that. And you knew how to run the big diesels, because he was one of the nicest people you'll ever meet. It was our engineering officer. But he insisted that you did your job and you knew your job. So.
And if you did that, it was okay.
And I think that's what saved us. We didn't have any engine trouble or anything. We just kept going even through the typhoon, and that's what happened to a lot of ships. See,
their engines went out.
Their equipment just went to pots.
And they just floundered.
Yeah.
So. Wow.
But
Were you ever fired upon in battle?
No, you're never
unfortunate enough to have that happen. That's good.
No, they use it more for transportation.
Yeah.
And fuel oil. And
what campaigns did you serve in? Guadalcanal or things like that?
No.
Just the final stages toward Japan.
Yeah.
When it got real rough. Yeah. No fun. Back to Sylvan Beach. Was there, as I remember, you mentioned the Howell Cottage. Wasn't there a fire at some point down at that end of White Lake, Sylvan Beach side?
Oh, yeah. There were 7 cottages burned there.
Now, do you remember what year that was approximately?
No. No, that was before. Mm-mm. I couldn't even tell you what year that was. 37, I think.
Okay.
I'm sure it's 37 because, right after the war, I went to work for Chester Specklemeyer and pretty near everything he had. He was working in the cottages at the time.
Yeah, he did a tremendous amount of work on all the cottages, just about.
And of course, he lost a lot of equipment. He'd been working in the houses, and of course, his equipment was in the houses when they burned. And why I say 37, the new stuff that he replaced, he put a date on him, 37.
I'll be darned.
Now, see, this could have been in 36, too, but I think it was 37.
How many of the 7 cottages were rebuilt, do you think?
Well, I think they'd come down to Mrs. Chittenden's, or which is Harriet Pearson's.
Okay.
Now, from there on up, I think there's 5 in there, isn't there?
Yeah, I think there's about 5.
I think 5 of them are replaced out of the 7.
Okay.
Because you see, I can remember them, but they were smaller cottages, you know.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't require the footage and the lots. And I think that's why only 5 of them were replaced.
Okay. How soon after the fire were they replaced? About 37, immediately they started?
They started right back.
So like
I imagine just a couple of years they had all the houses back up.
Do you have any idea how that fire started? Was it lightning or electricity?
I don't think they ever found out.
No.
It could have been electric or something. What I know, they never did really find out what happened.
What time of year did that happen?
It was in the winter, I believe. Because I recall, somebody told me this, now I don't remember who that was even, but even had the Muskegon Fire Department out there.
Wow, they came all the way out for that. And I guess, well, there's a chance all those might have gone.
Yeah.
So they had to be careful.
Yeah.
When did this, speaking of fire trucks, there's a tradition that still goes on at Sylvan Beach of testing the fire hoses, and the fire department comes down and they test the fire hoses and shoot them, and the children run out and get wet and play with the firemen, and they ride the fire truck. Do you remember if that began during your tenure, or was that done for decades before, or is that something that was recent?
During my time.
Was during your time?
Yeah, we got a hold of Carl Schultz, Montague Fire Chief, and we got talking one day and thought it'd be kind of nice if come out with their equipment. Because Sylvan Beach contributed pretty good, you know, to the fire district at that time. And they thought it'd be just a good, sincere thing to do, so they'd bring out a couple of trucks and give the kids a ride. And of course, I like to test the hoses anyway.
Yeah.
So we thought, well, why not just kind of make a little party out of it? And we got all through. I always had the boys stop over, and I always had a case of beer for them out of my own pocket. They didn't come out of the resort.
Association, of course.
And so we got all through. We'd stop there and chew the fat for a little while and have a beer.
Do you remember what year that was?
No.
Okay.
But we did it for quite a few years. But I couldn't tell you.
Well, they still do it now. That's quite a tradition that you began there that's been a part of a lot of people's childhood.
Oh, gosh, the kids just love it.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And some of the older ones.
Those are the adults. I've ridden that truck in before in my 30s, I think, even.
Got Miss Pelton in there one night.
Oh, did you really?
Yeah, she rode up with the, right up with the chief in the truck.
I'll be darned.
So.
That's quite a thing to have begun, Jack. That's great. Can you recall the most famous person that you ever met at Sylvan Beach?
Oh, gosh. Well, let's see, what was his name? One of the Roosevelts.
Elliot, probably, married to Ruth.
Elliot Roosevelt, it was probably. Because when the old Sylvan Beach Hotel was there, of course the Myers, especially their son Floyd, he and I were real good friends, so we spent quite a bit of time, you know, together. Either over to our place or me over at the hotel. And Mr. Roosevelt, he stayed there.
I'll be darned.
And we sat in the kitchen and had coffee with him.
I'll be darned.
It's quite a number of years ago.
And that's the president's son then at that time.
Yeah,
yes.
Yeah.
I'll be darned. So that's probably the most famous person that you can recall that came down there. Was he a nice man?
Oh, yes.
Yes,
as I remember, he was really...
Very decent.
You wouldn't know him with it. He was running the hotel.
Now, you mentioned this name, Meyer. Now, the Meyers were the family that ran the Sylvan Beach Hotel?
In the latter years, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Do you remember who ran it before them? Or?
It was Dudenhofer.
Dudenhofer. Okay.
The one that owned the Michelinda Beach Lodge, originally.
Oh, the guy.
And so he had that, and can't tell you when the Meyers took it over. A long time ago, too. But
what was the biggest wedding you remember down there? I mean, those must have been a hassle for you at times. Was there any one in particular that?
No, I never had. I can't recall having too much to do with those weddings. Make sure the yard was cleaned, I guess.
That was about it.
But no, I must say, all hired people. Oh, we used to take chairs and stuff, you know, different functions from the yacht, WAB club.
Okay.
And if they wanted a lot of seating, well, we'd haul up a bunch of chairs for them or little things like that. Nothing serious.
Okay. Do you remember when you first came there, how many cottages had phones? Did your caretaker house have a phone?
Or? Oh, yeah.
Okay,
oh,
did it
I think Bernard, everybody had a phone.
A phone, then.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, Chuck says phones were plentiful.
Okay. Yeah. The water tower up there, can you tell me something about that? Why it's there, when it was put there, when its heyday was? Is it still being used?
That I couldn't. I don't know. I think they still use it.
Still use that, yeah.
Of course, when I went there, they had to. No. They just replaced the old wooden tank. Just maybe a year before I got there, they had the old wooden tank up there.
Mm-hmm.
And then they put the metal one up. And it's still there.
Now, is that water pumped from down at the well areas on the flats there mm-hmm. and then pumped up to that tower?
Yeah.
Okay, so it's a gravity feed system then?
That's right.
Okay.
Okay. So it just goes up there and filters down into the cottages.
Okay.
But I understand now that everybody has to have their own well.
Yeah, I think that is the situation.
So there. Probably the only thing they use that for anymore then is a little sprinkling and fire protection would be the only thing I can think of.
Okay.
And,
you mentioned a very famous old name, Chester Spickelmeyer. How many years did you work for Mr. Spickelmeyer?
About 3-4 years.
Okay.
Not too long. I got out of the service and I went back to the shop and was going to continue my shop work there, because your seniority went out and everything. And I asked them what my pay was going to be, and said one thing, and when I got paid, I got another thing, so I closed my toolbox and went home.
Certainly can't blame you for that.
And I just got through eating supper, and the phone rang. Chester says, "What are you doing?" I says, "Nothing right now. Do you want to go to work?" I says, "Yep." So the next day, I went to work for Chester.
I'll be darned. Mr. Spiegelmeyer, Chester built a lot of the cottages down there, didn't he? Or
he built quite a few of them,
quite a few of them, yeah.
Between he and Arvid Wahlgren, he built some. In fact, it is Arvid Wahlgren built this one.
Built right here?
Yeah. This is one of Arvid's houses. He built some. Chester did quite a few of them.
Well, Chester kind of stayed basically working for the people at Sylvan Beach, didn't he? And, fixing cottage, adding on, doing things like that. I have heard that Mr. Spiegelmeyer wasn't very good at measuring things. Was this true? Or
no. You're very particular.
Very particular. Okay, then that's an old myth.
Well, maybe his dad.
Okay.
Old now, man. Maybe that. Yeah. The old gent. No, Chester was very, very accurate.
Now, where did the Spiegelmeyers live?
Right down there on the road there that goes past the wells.
Okay, down in the flatlands there.
Right out on the lake.
Okay. Yeah, it's a big place right on the lake down there. Okay.
Yeah, his dad lived right on the point, and Chester's was next. So, and his shop was down there. And,
well, Jack, I think that's about all. It's been a pleasure. Thank you. We will present.